Hi everyone! For this sixth video of the series about Budo in life, I have Baptiste Tavernier, with whom I've already made an interview a few years ago about his background in martial arts. So today we're going to talk Budo in life. So if you want to know more about his background, you can check out the first interview we did a few years ago. So this interview will be in English, despite the fact we are both French, because the series is in English and there will be no subtitles. So French speakers, well, shouldn't be too difficult for you with your ugly French accent. And English speakers, please forgive this heretic, two French guys speaking English. Okay, so Baptiste, thank you for accepting this interview. Baptiste practices
a lot of stuff.
Budo, Kobudo. He's also an artist, an expert on Japanese heraldry. Kamon.
Yes.
He knows a lot of things about how the Budo world works in Japan, especially the Kendo world and the Budo Daigaku.
Yeah, I mean, I've been working with Kendo world and with Alex Bennett and everybody, but I'm not an expert in Kendo because I don't do Kendo, right?
Yeah, yeah. But you know.
But I know a bit about Kendo, but I'm not a Kendoka.
Yeah, well, I mean, the federation and how things work.
Oh, yeah, yeah, the Budokan and everything, the politics and all of that. Very cool stuff, yeah, of course.
Today, we'd like to talk about, first, what led you from Budo in Japan, because you came to Japan for Budo in the first place, to your current situation and work, so our art mainly. And then maybe after explaining how you reached that, how is the work being an artist? I don't even know if I can call that a work, but you'll tell us.
Well, I mean, it's a pleasant work. It's not like working in a mine or anything like that, but yeah. Okay, so the thing is, it's not like I went from Budo to art. It's actually quite the opposite. I was an artist or a musician, composer, and all sorts of things when I was living in France, in Paris. And then I moved to Japan to study martial arts, so I kind of broke away from art and music and everything. And then after studying in Japan at the Budo University for like 7 years or something, I kind of needed or wanted to go back to the art field, which is my major. I mean, basically I was doing my PhD in Paris and it was on art and music. So, but my major is art and music, not martial arts, technically, yeah.
Yeah, but you started mainly with music, and now you're doing completely different kind of art. So, what was the process that?
Okay, so it doesn't involve Budo at all, but we can talk about it if you want. So I was a composer and I was doing a PhD in musicology and music history and all sorts of things. And actually, contemporary music and avant-garde and experimental music. So we were using a lot of artificial intelligence and stuff like that. I'm talking about like 20 years ago or something. So it's not the artificial intelligence we know nowadays. It's like long time ago, right? And I used to work a lot with dance, actually, dance choreographers and dance company, and we did real-time music and video performance. So we were working both on music and video feed image and dance. So it's kind of like a very art total, as we say in France. And I was, of course, practicing martial arts back in the days. Actually, I started when I was a kid, like I was doing judo like everybody does in France. And then I was doing Naginata in Paris. And some bojutsu and stuff in France too, anyway. And so at the time, martial art was kind of like something cool to do when you're an artist, because it's supposed to make you zen or this kind of crap. But of course, that's a lot of cliche and a lot of bullshit. But you don't know about that unless you come to Japan, right? And so I was doing the cliche stuff, and I'm really enjoying. I mean, when you're a beginner, that's where you enjoy martial arts the most, because you don't know anything. So you do stupid stuff and it's fun to do, right? Like Japan Expo and all that stuff in Paris. Yeah, so I was enjoying that too. And then I decided I wanted to dig a bit deeper in martial arts, and then I decided to go to Japan, right? So I didn't finish my PhD. Thank God, I was boring. But yeah, and so this question, actually, you get it a lot, right? Like, oh, you do martial arts and do you art? Oh, does martial arts affect your art? It's like, because everybody's expecting, oh yeah, it makes you zen, or, you know, it's, I'm working on my breathing and then I can paint better. So, but actually not really. It's like martial arts doesn't really impact how a photographer work or a painter, I would say, unless you're kind of like filming or shooting or painting martial arts stuff, maybe. But otherwise, I mean, whatever breathing technique or ninja trick, you know, doesn't really help you paint, I would say. But and then to quote an old friend, Alex Bennett, because I think I remember we were talking about that in Kyoto, very late at night and with a lot of beer on the table, Guinness, of course. And it was like, we were talking exactly about, it's like, oh yeah, art in martial arts is very connection and stuff. And yeah, no, not really. And then he said something really interesting. He said, yeah, but like, if you think about kendo or naginata, or like, well, let's say kendo, I mean, maybe there's not a link between art and kendo, the way you do art, but there might be a link between the way you promote art. Like, do you, how aggressive are you to promote your art or to sell your art? And then he kind of like made different, in kendo, there's a lot of like, you do the way you do keiko, some people are kind of passive, more people are aggressive. Some people just like attack randomly. And there's a lot of different things happening in keiko. And then it was like kind of like making parallels between each type of kendo styles and the way you can sell and promote art in galleries. And yeah, and yeah, I really thought a lot about you know, this aspect of art, because making art, of course, it's cool, but at some point you need to sell it too, right? Otherwise, you're not a professional artist, you're just amateur who enjoy doing art, which is pretty good, but if you want to make a living out of it, you need to sell at some point. And I think, in a way, martial arts and the way you think about fighting and this kind of thing is more or less the way you should approach, like, yeah, selling to a collection, a collector, or go, when you go to an art fair, like, you know, Basel in Miami or wherever, or in Hong Kong. How do you talk to people, or do you promote your stuff?
Yeah, you mean in some ways, what Sun Tzu wrote in the Art of War or stuff like that, the strategy. In human communication.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, if you want to use Sun Tzu, yeah, to do some business, or like Musashi Golin no Sho, to do some, I don't know, kaisha, I mean, like company managing, yeah, you can, but does it really work?
But if you don't practice, probably not, but if you do practice.
If you do practice. So it's an interesting field, I would say. When they first, you remember when they first they did the Golin no Sho, so the, what's the English title again for Golin no Sho? The Five Rings. The Golin no Sho translation in English was Victor Harris, I think, the first translation, yeah, probably.
First.
Victor Harris, I think. And then it was branded or marketed as manual for business, right? How to do business. How why Japanese companies are really successful in the world, and Japan is number one, like we're talking about like 40 years ago or something, yeah?
Yeah, that's
yeah, 40 70s. Years ago. Yeah, end of the 70s and 80s, so more than 40 years ago. And why Japan is number one now and blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, the marketing stuff for the Golin no Sho was, because it's the samurai businessmen. It's like, they're doing the Musashi stuff and we can't beat them. It's like, but to some point, maybe you can use it. It's interesting, but it was mostly a marketing coup, right? And it was a kind of a genius coup, but not so many people actually studied this kind of stuff. Maybe it's in, maybe there's something there. I don't know. Like really study Golin no Sho, Heo Kaden Sho, whatever, and then say, oh, can you apply that in real life situation for business or stuff? I don't know, maybe.
I think you really need to practice when you
yeah, I mean, you need to be a good kendoka and you all do kobudo or something. If you just read the book and say, oh, I read I don't know Funomaki and I understand all the stuff about all the flaws of the other companies, doesn't work. It's like, yeah, you need to.
Yeah, when you read that Alex's books, so that his translation that came out recently, but even the past books on Bushido and stuff like that, it's much more understandable than past translations or books on the subject. I think because he added some elements of...
But the thing is, like when Victor Harris did it, it was like, what, 40 years ago? It was a pioneer, right? And pioneer works are never... Kampiki, they're never, you know, perfect or best. It's like, it's the
but
pioneer.
We've seen many translations of that.
Yeah, many are, some are okay, some are really bad. Some are actually pretty good. I mean, there's so many translations. My translation is good, man, but it's in French.
Yeah, it's not the Five Rings, it's the...
No, it's the Sanjugo Kajo, but anyway, yeah. It's good.
Yeah. I know, I read it.
And so yeah, there's a good translation and not so good, but whatever. And the thing with Alex is like, it's the last one, is the last translation. So
yeah, he benefits so it, from all the past translations.
Yeah, but that's a benefit and also a non-benefit at all, because you can say, oh, I can actually see what other people did, but then you shouldn't do it too much because otherwise you kind of lose your own. So it's very hard to... Okay, we all did it. I need to do it again, but I need to do it better. And actually reading and having the old one might not be that convenient, I would say. I'm not sure. When I did my translation, I didn't read much. Oh, there was no translation.
There was
the
no
Sanjuka, true. But there was the Golin no Sho. And I worked on Uzumi Sensei's books based on that, because he was my sensei at the time and he had so many books on Musashi. So. And the thing is, like, for what was the question again? Because I mean, we're talking about me, and not like we're being talking about Alex all the
talking,
time.
Like, you started it.
I like him, but like, it's supposed to be about me, right?
we were talking about Budo's strategy life and in business, in your business at first.
Like, yeah, true. But anyway, so Golin no Sho and all that stuff, it's probably interesting to study from a business and everything, but you definitely need to be a kendoka or a budoka or kobudoka. I don't know if there's a word for that. Otherwise, it's just text and there's no meaning behind it.
Why not write a book about how you manage your negotiations with your art galleries?
Yeah, I'm pretty bad at it, actually. I need to study Musashi more. It's like, anyway, nowadays the COVID-19 era, so there's no much art stuff going around. And actually, it's very interesting to be honest. It's a tough period to live in, right? And we all had, relatives who died or who were seriously ill. And so it's not an easy period, right? But then at the same time, I find it very exciting because all the cards are reshuffled somehow. You know, everybody used to do that and that and that. And we're like, I would say in French, everybody had la tête dans le guidon. So like this, and nobody sees what's going on the left or on the right. But with everything stopped and everything reshuffled, you have to say, oh, wait a minute, I've been doing that for 20 years or something, and now, for example, martial arts, I've been doing it like for like 15 years or whatever in Japan, and then years before in France, and I was doing that all the time. I was like, only martial arts, kendo world, Naginata stuff, and Jukendo, promoting Jukendo and Tankendo, and Meiji Jingu Embu, and Kashima Embu, and then helping video youth from time to time, and all tons of stuff, right? It never stops. And then at some point you say, oh man, we've been doing that for 15 years. And it's like, oh man, yeah, time flies, right? And then suddenly everything stops, right? If there was no corona, there would have been no corona, no COVID-19, we would probably continue on the same track, right? And it's like, okay, Meiji, Kagami Biraki, Budokan, da da na 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 na. And then everything stops and it's like, okay, there's no martial arts anymore, even in Japan, right? Because, I mean, in Europe or in the States, definitely in Europe, nobody can train, right? Most, I don't know what happens in the US or in New Zealand or Australia or each country is different, right? But, and a lot of people might think, oh, Japan doesn't have so much cases of COVID-19, which is true compared to other countries. But it's not like everybody can still train. So I don't know, for Aikido, how's the Aikikai?
Aikido is mostly private dojos, so they are still running. But everything that is based on university, police, and military, so right, basically kendo, jukendo, and stuff like that, becomes more difficult to practice.
Like I used to be to do some classes from time to time, right, at Budai, at Budo University, and also teach some of the foreign students. Well, that's gone. And they still, 2 years after, they still don't train in Budai. There's no kendo, no bukatsu, nothing. I think I heard they kind of started again and they train like five guys in the dojo at the time and they do like from far away. I don't know exactly what they do, but they don't do kendo, right? It's kind of like a light version of what it should be. Jukendo, tankendo, yeah, that's a bit, because it's the military, right? And there are private dojo too, but it's very small number. But in the military, in the Kanto area, so Saitama, Tokyo, Kanagawa, Chiba, at least, maybe Gunma also, I'm not sure, Ibaraki, the military doesn't have the right, they cannot train, it's forbidden. Because they think if there's a cluster in the military and for whatever reason we need the military, that's not the time to do freaking kendo or jukendo, right? Mm-hmm.
Man, yeah. Same with the police,
yeah,
except for the guys who go to izakaya and restaurants late at night and get caught. But theoretically, should be ready to.
Well, I mean, everybody gets caught in the izakaya. it's the trap, man. It's the izakaya trap. But
serious guys are supposed to be serious and not train and avoid any risks.
Indeed. Most of them are, but a few are not, and yeah, they get caught. Yeah, true. But the military in Kanto, they cannot train. But then if you go to, I don't know, Aomori or Totori or whatever, they can train, actually, because at some point they had no cases, nothing, right? So they just trained. Maybe maybe they had to stop for a certain period of time, but in Tokyo or in the Kanto area, you still cannot do Jukendo or Tankendo. They can't. And somewhere else in Japan, they can. And it's starting to be interesting because although, of course, competition and everything is not the most important thing, but in fact, it kind of is. Taikai, the next championship for Jukendo and Tankendo, there's going to be like Jukendo generally is in August and Tankendo is in February. And some people can train a lot and some people couldn't train at all. And is it fair to do a competition or not? We're kind of like struggling right now with this, at least in Jukendo and Tankendo. I don't know for the other martial arts, right? But
It should be the same for Kendo, for example.
Probably, but the championship was like 2 weeks ago in Kendo. Or something, 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago? It was the old Japan. And there were no policemen, right? It was only students and stuff. Yeah, obviously.
I thought actually that it was the old university championship.
No, it was the old Japan. But there's no policemen, no. It's the official All Japan, and for the first time, I think they had male and female at the same time, obviously, because I don't know, it was too easier to
well,
do like that.
All Japan, if you take the police and the military, there are not many adults left.
Well, in kendo, it's okay. In jukendo, if you remove the military, then there's me and there's a bunch of guys, and it's cool, but yeah, it's not going to be fun, that's for sure. But yeah, anyway, so COVID 19 times are kind of interesting, and you cannot do martial arts. So what do you do? Some people do Zoom, like Zoom session, you know, like I hate it. I don't do it. I did it once with Alex, actually. And it's just like, I don't know, it's a waste of time for me. The Zoom thing, I think it's good because it keeps the community alive. Yeah, yeah. You have a lot of people and they say, oh, let's meet on Zoom and talk about stuff and do a bit of suburi. At least the community doesn't collapse or crumble. But in terms of like martial art training...
Well, it can be interesting for physical training, physical exercises.
Yeah, but you don't need Zoom to do that. You just do push-ups in your kitchen.
For the motivation, doing it together. Mm. But it's not martial arts, you know?
If you
judoka do a lot of push-ups, but push-ups is not judo. So.
No, exactly. Like, well, I mean, if I do tanken, I can do tanken in my apartment. It's a small bear. Yeah. If you do naginata, you're screwed. So, and some people are doing like, yeah, suburi. But then, yeah, suburi, you don't need Zoom to do it. You can do it alone. So, yeah, we don't do that. I don't do that. We started something new, though, recently with the Jukendo Federation. It's just like we just started like a week ago or something. It's like if you have a dojo somewhere and if you can train, if you're authorized to train, because in France or maybe in Belgium or in the UK you cannot train like yet, it's forbidden. But let's say for example in Taiwan, there were no confinement, no nothing. They've been living their normal life since the beginning of the pandemic. They only had 1 week or 2 weeks maybe at the beginning, yeah, where the dojo was closed. But then the Jukendo in Taiwan, Tankendo Association or Federation, they've been training. They train more than in Japan, actually. That's like, and so what we do, but they don't have any sensei there, right? And nobody can travel anymore. So what we try to do is we have the dojo, and we put like three or four cameras in different angles in the dojo. They do their normal training session, and then we have senseis in Japan checking what we do. And if they see something pretty bad or mistakes or something, we talk like real time and say, oh, can you fix that? Maybe this exercise, you do it too fast or too low, maybe do it different way. And it's kind of like, it's not a Zoom session where everybody's in the kitchen or in the living room and doing stuff. It's in the dojo with the sensei. It's just that the sensei is not there. And that works actually pretty good. So we're planning to do that with all the other countries soon. So yeah, that's a good system.
Well, it's easier when you just have a couple dozens dojo to handle.
Well, of course. I mean, but then again, I mean, you could do that as like if you can train in a dojo somewhere in the world and you have like 10 students or 20 students. There's so many kendo teachers in Japan that it should be easy to implement something where one teacher can take care of one country or one area or something, and you know, it's possible.
Yeah. That would require the Kendo Federation to make some decisions and organize something.
Organizing stuff in Japan always takes time, but it's possible, definitely. But so you cannot do, what do you do when you cannot train? Some people kind of lament because we cannot do training anymore. And I understand that because, you know, I'm kind of like, yeah, I miss the training a bit. But the less you do and the less you miss it, actually, somehow. It's like, oh, it's kind of like distance.
The more you do and the more you want to do, and the less you do, the less you miss it.
Yeah, exactly.
Pretty true.
But what do you do when you can't do it? Well, myself, I'm kind of like use the opportunity to do something completely new. Or not new, but like, so I do more art. I went back to music a lot and... I'm learning right now 3D printing, you know, I bought the machine and I'm printing stuff, and that's cool. So you have so many stuff you can learn, and also you can still do a lot of body weight training and make sure you're ready when everything starts again, right? So yeah, anyway, so COVID-19, interesting. Well, you know, the GHQ didn't kill the martial arts after the war, and they couldn't train for 5 years, so I don't think COVID-19 is gonna kill the martial arts either. Just be only 2 years, right? So
yeah, well, it hurts.
It might change it and might impact it in a way that martial arts might change somehow, but kill it, I don't think so. Like the way the GHQ ban after the war impacted the martial art and changed it forever, make it more like kind of a closer to a sports system than a, you know, a combat system before the war, or a propaganda system, I would say. But you know, that the GHQ changed the martial arts forever, that's for sure. So maybe the COVID-19 will change the martial arts again, but is it a good thing or a bad thing? I don't know.
As far as it stays relevant to the people.
Hmm. I mean. So what was your question again?
Okay, so do you see any connection between martial arts and arts? I mean, in the sense, for example, technically speaking, when I'd say rhythm in practice, rhythm in music, or even now the Embu are all about that, but also early Meiji period when the Kenjutsu stayed alive because of shows. That were
organized like Gekken Kogyo,
yeah,
you mean?
Yeah,
but I mean, show is not really art, right? I mean, it's a bit different. Well, in my case, the question would be, does martial arts should be on, you know, pay-per-view, TV cable stuff? And that's more like the Gekken Kogyo at the end of the 19th century was more like, having a kind of like a channel on YouTube or somewhere when you can watch martial arts and keep it alive. But is it related to art? I'm not sure. But martial arts and art...
Cinema is considered an art. So if you're playing a role...
Yeah, of course. But then it's not really martial arts anymore. It's more tate, right? It's like a stunt.
Yeah. I don't say martial arts is like stunt, but martial arts has this component. Even today we do lots of embu, and embu has never been about showing... how to fight to people. It has always been about a performance.
Well, there's like martial arts, martial arts famous masters, many of them were also artists in a sense. Like, I think the best example is Teshu, Yamaoka Teshu. It's a very well-known calligrapher, right? And then he used to say Kenzenichi, I think, or Kenzenichi Nyo. It's like Kendo, Zen, and Shodo calligraphy together. That's the same thing. And he was, so he's famous for his calligraphy and he's famous for his Kenjutsu. I don't know if he did Kendo, but definitely he did Mutoryu, so it was a Itoryu component. I don't know if he did Geken. Maybe he did. I would need to ask Alex.
I don't know.
He's the historian on that. But, his calligraphy are masterpieces nowadays. And for him, definitely calligraphy and kendo and zen were like intricated. So there's definitely some aspect like that. And I'm sure as an artist, if you decide that, like, I know some artists in the US, they will work on Zen, for example. Zen is very interesting, it's interested in Zen, and they work on Zen and they integrate Zen into their artwork. You can definitely decide to integrate martial arts into your artworks too. It's just about how you do it, how do you integrate it. Let me see. If you decide that, the way you do kendo, or the way you do naginata, or aikido. Oh, no, well, easy example. Aikido. Aikido is the easiest way to grasp, but because it's been used by so many dancers.
Hence my question, actually.
Especially if you're in Europe, you probably know Kinomichi.
Yeah.
I mean, you know because you're an Aikido guy, but some people who don't do Aikido might not know Kinomichi, but
Yeah, Kinomichi
it was a Noro sensei, right?
Noro sensei, yeah. It's obviously a form of theatrical human expression that is based on Aikido movements, but that is not Aikido in itself.
My Noro sensei was an Aikidoka, right?
But yeah,
he
created Kinomichi from Aikido, being a very high level Aikidoist himself.
But then the legacy, once the founder or the sensei, the main sensei, dies, then the next people who come in don't necessarily have the background in martial arts or Aikido. They have the background in Kinomichi, right? So this is where I guess it start to take a different trajectory. But then the Kinomichi, I think, influenced a lot of dancers in Europe, at least in France, I'm sure. I know many, many choreographers and
also
been trained in Kinomichi.
I see the Kobayashi Hirokazu line with André Cognard.
Cannot imagine André Cognard dancing, but
he has always been pretty rough on the mats.
Yeah, but, yeah.
No, he has lots of students that are dancers and circus performers.
Ah, okay. Circus, yeah, definitely. Circus, why not?
I've met some people with crazy physical abilities in his school, and their performance were clearly inspired and nourished with Aikido. And the opposite wasn't necessarily true, because their Aikido was quite what the school is teaching, so that there is this component probably up to a certain level in martial art that you have to keep your kata, you have to keep learning the form, while in the art they could use some Aikido and express themselves more freely. So that's interesting.
Also for us, a dancer, again, I'm not a dancer, right? I'm not. I'm very terrible at dancing, but I've been working with dancers and choreographer quite for a long time, actually, in many, many different projects. And if you do ballet, classic dance, you don't call it a kata, but there's so many different exercises you need to master, right? I don't know, grand pas de chat, en tout cas grand jeté, pirouette, there's a lot of stuff, right? And the way it's taught at the opera in Paris, I'm sure the way we teach it right now is probably, I guess, maybe I'm wrong, and maybe a dancer can correct me, but the way we teach it nowadays is probably the same way they used to teach it 100 years ago or something. It's kind of a kata too. Maybe it's evolved, of course. Martial arts evolved in much, much shorter periods, so 100 years, a lot of evolutions happening, but same for the dance. But in a way, it's a kata. So the dance and the martial arts world are really easy to connect. Same with Maurice Béjart, who had the ballet in Lausanne. All the students of Béjart were kind of required to do kendo. Yeah. It was a requirement, they had to do kendo. And I don't know, again, Bartabas, you know, Bartabas was a famous choreographer for dance and horse dance. So he does a lot of horse mixing with dancer. It's kind of cool. And if I'm not mistaken, all his students are required to do kudo, if I'm not mistaken, I think. Or at least at some point they had to do, maybe. I don't know if they still do it or not, but anyway. So there's a lot of, and obviously because you're using the body, right? Say if you're a dancer, or if you do if you're, as we say in French, a circassien, so a circus artist, you need to use your body. So martial arts is definitely a good stuff you can study and master. And it makes probably impacts the way you dance or you do circus or whatever. And probably the way you dance also impacts your martial arts at some point. But although dance being an art, you can adapt and change a lot of stuff. If you start to adapt your kata based on your dance, maybe the sensei is not going to be really happy about it. But I don't know. In Japan, there's not much art and martial arts connection. I mean, the only thing is like shodo or chi. Obviously, people who study chi.
Progressive arts are not really
Well, so like traditional, yeah. So traditional arts and martial arts work well together, and then yeah, in tea, a lot of people, and then foreigners like Randy Channel is a tea master, and he used to do a lot of kendo, and he's been, you know, studying and the relations, and he's been talking about it for a long time, right? And then so Kenzencho with Yamaoka Teshu. I don't see Alex Bennett doing any dancing or drawing or music, but maybe he has a hidden talent. He hasn't told us yet. But yeah, a lot of people actually do the traditional martial arts and the traditional arts, but not so much the arts like Gendai art, contemporary art.
Would you see, for example, a connection between someone who knows music well and has the sense of rhythm of can read and understand rhythm and the ability to learn faster some aspects of martial arts because of the rhythm in the kata or the rhythm is the connection with the partner, for example?
I don't know. I have no idea. If I take my own experience, so I'm used to be a drummer, play jazz drumming. Used to be a steel drummer, you know, steel drum like the Caribbean instrument. I play crystal balls. I do a lot of percussion. So I'm a percussionist and a drummer, and I can read very complex rhythm and, you know, even in music. So I have a sense of rhythm when I play the music, right? But I have no freaking sense of rhythm when if you ask me to dance. I look like an idiot. I have no sense of rhythm at all when it comes to dancing, because I think it's something you need to learn, right, somehow. And then being a good musician, doesn't translate into dance, is it going to translate into martial arts? I'm not sure. I think if you're gifted for dance, maybe. If you're an idiot like me, I'm not sure. Probably not.
Asking because Hino Akira told me that one. He's also
Hino Sensei?
A free jazz player.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Drum. and he plays like crazy
free jazz, like
experimental jazz.
Like back in the days, like Albert Ayler and this kind of free jazz?
Kind of more experimental.
Oh, even more experimental than that.
Yes, okay. Well, it depends. I've only seen two concerts with him. He's not a famous jazz artist, but he does concerts sometimes. And he told me, you suck at martial arts because you don't have the rhythm and you should do music. And I've tried and I failed, but...
I don't know, because I know a lot of people who are very good at martial arts, but can we do music? I'm not sure. I think Guillaume is a bass player, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there's some connection, but I don't think it's that important.
Could you... let's take the question from a completely different side, different perspective. Could you write a piece of music based on the rhythm of a kata, for example?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I've been...
That would be an interesting artistic approach.
Contemporary music composer, right? So I studied in IRCAM in Paris, and I mean, not IRCAM, but like something like that. It was like very avant-garde, like Pierre Boulez stuff, like very crazy shit with people screaming and you're killing a cat, and then you're recording the sound, then you mix it with some tin foil, and I mean, like very weird stuff, right? So, like music serial and all that stuff. Like, anyway, the avant-garde, right? And so people like that can create music and write music with whatever, you know, whatever you can find. Like, if you just use like music concrete, you can use whatever you can record in nature or in the city. And so writing a piece of music based on kata rhythm or martial arts rhythm, sounds pretty easy. I don't remember the name of the composer, but I think I remember like one guy once composed a kind of a full orchestral kind of symphony following the actions of a football match. So there was like, kind of like a very romantic, like 19th century music.
Football, soccer.
Soccer.
For American friends.
Not American football. And then like there will be like the action and the guy is going, and then there's a tension in the music, it's kind of a drama, and then the guy at the defense like push the guy, and then there's a penalty kick, and then the music is like, oh, I mean, what's happening? And then the guy scores the penalty, and then trumpet, and all. So it was kind of exercise that's been done already. And yeah, so I don't know the name of the guy, but like, definitely you can do the same with martial arts. And in a sense, when you do music for movies, movie industry, I mean, you need to compose the music based on what's happening on the, you know, on the screen, right? So if there's a martial arts combat or something, you kind of compose the music for that. And then
I was actually really thinking about the Star Wars old laser cyber fights and the music that comes with it, which I think
is Star Wars, like the old ones.
They're the old ones, yeah, yeah, because the rhythm in the new ones are really different, and it's very far from martial arts.
I haven't seen the new ones, sorry guys.
In the old ones, there is a rhythm in the fight that is quite close to Kobudo kata rhythm, I think.
The way they fight the old Star Wars, well, it's definitely very slow and very heavy, right? Compared to the, so, I mean, I don't really see it in my mind much, but like at the first, like Obi-Wan Kenobi versus Darth Vader, they almost don't move. Looks a bit like a Kendo Hachidan Sensei's fight, right? And then there's only one or two attack. Yeah, well, but then when you need to compose the music for that, you need to take that into account, right? And then maybe the music John Williams made at the time for that fight, which is very heavy, very slow, is definitely not the same music he did for the new Star Wars. Is he still composing for the new Star Wars?
The 1, 2, 3, I think so. But so 7, 8, 9, I don't know.
I have no idea. I mean, I didn't see them. I saw the first one, and then I said, no, nothing, no more. And then, but yeah, if you take like them, the one with the Bugs Bunny dude, like Jar Jar. So that trilogy, the music is much faster and much than the old one. So definitely is adapting to the rhythm of martial arts of the saber laser saber fight. So when you do music for martial arts stuff, you kind of follow the, yeah, you need to follow what's going on there. So there's a connection there if you want to look for connections. Now, do you want to find connections between martial arts and painting, for example? I don't know. I think it's a good question. And I think each artist will have a different answer about that somehow. Mm.
Do you think there is a things, skills, qualities you acquired practicing martial arts that helped you?
Okay, so to practice martial arts, one of the big skill you need is like the sense of observation. Like sometimes I see, especially I would say more in the West, like in Europe, than in Japan. I find that like if you take beginners, really beginners level in Japan and in France or in Europe, there's one big difference is in Japan, they observe, they don't talk much, but sometimes they talk, but like they really observe what you do. And if you do something, we're going to stop and look what you're doing, right? In France, sometimes you show stuff and then the guys are chit-chatting and then it's like they don't really actually look at what you're doing. Then how can they actually learn properly if you don't? You know, so the level of focusing or the level of attention as
and the concept of Mitori Geiko is not very
not really, yeah. And what was the question again?
The quality skills acquired.
I think if you need to be really good at observing, right? Now if you do painting or like portrait or whatever, you need to be good at observing too, obviously, right? Because if you try to paint a very beautiful woman and you don't really observe, you know, her face and like the light on the hair and all that stuff, then you end up with a cubist Picasso, right? Not the beautiful woman anymore. So you need to be, you need to observe a lot. That's for sure in martial arts. Two, quality you need is...
What about body mechanics?
No, I mean, seriously, there are a few people that are kind of geniuses, but when you start martial arts, like 95% of the beginner, they're beginners, so of course they suck. They don't know how to move properly, and especially true in the West, they don't know how to place the koshiga haitenai. Like the way they use their hip and stuff is completely broken. But that was definitely the case for me when I studied martial arts too in France, right? It's like, and then you spend many, many years in Japan, and naturally this kind of koshi thing, hips rotation and placement, comes naturally at some point. But not because somebody is explaining you, oh, you should rotate your hips like this or like that. It's just like because you see everybody's moving like that, so you kind of like mimic it somehow, naturally. But in Europe, there's less opportunity to see that because there's the number of experienced people is lower than in Japan, obviously. If you go to a Kendo dojo in Paris, and in Paris they have a lot of nanadan, six dan, seven dan, hachi dan, Yoshimura sensei. There's many high-level kendo people in France, right? But compared to Japan, it's nothing. It's like there's like 10 guys, right? In Japan, 10 guys, you can find them in a small dojo teaching to kids on the Sunday morning, and they're all hachidan, right? So the opportunity to observe and mimic is much, much higher in Japan than in the West, definitely. Then again, I don't know in Aikido, you have much more Aikido practitioner in Europe than in Japan, that's for sure. I don't know the level. I mean, I know there's a lot of very high level sensei like Christian Tissier or Cognard. Or,
if you're looking at really the top teachers, I think there are more teachers in Japan than in France, but there's still many. I mean, from the time I started back 20 years ago, the level is much higher. I mean, when I started, I think Christian Tissier just got 7th dan or his 8th dan, which means that all the 6th dan, 5th dan of the time, or 6th dan, the 6th and 7th dan. So now the level is really high. But it also means that we have many students. Mm. Well, Aikido is in a bit of a crisis recently, so the number of students decreased.
Oh, yeah, but everywhere, I mean.
But we have a lot of beginners, so if you're trying to... If you're watching around you, same. If you go to a Christian Tissier seminar, you're gonna have like 10 people, 6 dan on the mat. But if you go to any regular dojo anywhere, you're gonna have a few people that are shodan, nidan, and the teacher,
and that's it.
Before them, and that's it. So
there's not much opportunity to observe, mimic, and learn from that.
You're talking about 1 million license in Japan. So even if in the paper.
In France, it's probably 5,000 or 6,000.
So. Yeah, and even Aikido is only maybe 80,000. So. Mm.
But so without that, it's hard to learn martial arts for sure. So then if you don't have anything to copy, tangible that you can see, I guess a lot of people start to use their brain and like say, oh, maybe if I do that, then that will happen, and then maybe I can use my body like this, and 45 degrees that, and 50 degrees this, and then it starts to completely crumble because it's
not natural.
Isn't
that the link with art, a skill that you can have in both martial arts and art, not thinking too much, and.
Well, the thing is, in art in Europe, let's say if you're a painter or if you're a dancer, I mean, all the masters are there. So it's reversed with Japan, right? I mean, in Japan, there's a few very famous artists, but not that many compared to Europe, where you have all the big schools and all the big famous choreographer, artists, whatever. And then you don't have much martial arts master. And then in Japan, you have a lot of martial arts people. We don't have much artists. Very famous artists, not so much. And most of the very famous composer or whatever, they end up in Paris or in New York anyway. So because there's no room for them in Japan if they want to grow. But like Seiji Ozawa, the conductor, I mean, they almost kicked him out of Japan when he was young. It's like, what are you doing? I mean, it's like, No. And then he went to, I think, New York or Paris. And then he get famous there. And then he get trained and get famous. And then in Japan, oh, come back. It's like a Japanese conductor, Seiji Ozawa. But at the beginning, they didn't even want him here. It's like, so a lot of artists, Japanese artists, dancer, choreographer, whatever, even makeup artists, even freaking Irezumi tattoo, yeah. They all have to get away from Japan if they want to survive, otherwise there's nothing for them here. And then so it's reversed with the martial arts, right? So if you do both, then you need to be sometime in Japan, and then you, this is where you learn your martial arts, and then you go back to Europe or to New York, or and then you work on your art thing. That's the best way, I think. But yeah, it's an interesting situation. But then again, the link between martial arts and art, I think, is not something you can conceptualize. It's most, I mean, like, oh, the link with martial arts, between martial arts and art is this. This is it. This is how it works. This is how it's been until now, and this is the future for it. There's no way it's just Junin Toiro, so 10 people, 10 colors, right, in Japan. So it means like everybody's different, and everybody's gonna have their own solution about that problem, if it's a problem, or that ID. And everybody's gonna find their own way to do it. But there shouldn't be, and especially not me, I'm an idiot, remember? So I'm not gonna say it's like, oh, martial arts and arts, this is it, breathing and the Zen. And it's like, yeah, if you're into Zen, maybe. If you don't give a shit about Zen, then probably not. That's like, it has to be your own, you need to make your own path, young Padawan. But yeah, so what's the next question?
So maybe that's...
Because you say it will be a short interview, and then it's going to be like 2 hours as usual,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, short 2 hours. Yeah. Short. usually we shoot for 3 hours and we keep 1 hour. Today it's short. We're shooting 2 hours. We're just and keeping
you, and,
2 hours.
And you keep 2 hours. Yeah, okay. Wow.
So maybe this is where the arts of martial arts, even though it's a English and French word, and it's not a Japanese word, because Budo is not martial art, it's martial ways, so it's not the same thing. Mm-hmm. But maybe it's where the art of martial art come from. That everyone follows his own path, and there is no standardized definitive vision of what it should be.
Well, I mean, that's a difficult question, I guess, or a difficult topic. Is there art in martial arts? I guess it depends. Do you make a difference between a combat system and martial arts, or do you think it's the same thing? I don't know. That's like, and is the martial arts a self-defense system, a combat system, a martial sport, an art? That's like there's so many words for that, and most of them mean nothing, because, okay, so let's say, I don't know, karate is a martial art, right? Okay, but it's also a martial sport, because it's an Olympic, or it's going to be an Olympic kamoku. I don't know the word in English, what's kamoku? Olympic sports, anyway, in the next Olympic in Tokyo, right? So it's a sport, but it's a martial arts, it's a martial sport. It's a combat system, because they teach karate, or at least they used to teach karate to military in many countries, I'm sure. They even teach ninja stuff, not to the military, so yeah. So it's a combat system, and is it an art too? I don't know, can a combat system be an art? Like I do Jukendo, I do bayonet, right? Is killing people with a bayonet an art? Maybe. It's going to be pretty difficult to do, you know? You need to be skillful, yeah. But you can elevate it as an art if you do kata, and if you do it as a budo, right? A martial way, like they do in Japan. But if there's like bayonet combat in the army, there's bayonet Jukendo budo, which is for the betterment of the, you know, like a ningen kese, so like self-realization and all that stuff. And then the techniques of Jukendo are actually quite beautiful. I mean, they seem very simple, but it's very intricate and very complex and simple at the time. So there's beauty in that too, you would say, if you're into that kind of stuff. But yeah, is it an art? I don't know. Is there art in martial arts? I guess each country is different, right? Like in China, you always had this kind of like division or separation between the military fighting system and then the civilian arts, so military arts, civilian arts. And this kind of distinction or separation doesn't really exist in Japan, right? There's no, oh, this is for the military and this is for the civilians, because technically there is no military. It's like the samurais are kind of something in between. And then they had a lot of technique, to like fighting techniques for battlefield and blah, blah, blah. But at the time, there were not so many martial arts school, right? Because most of the martial arts school came into existence at the end of Muromachi and Momoyama and Edo. So at the end of the Muromachi, they still fight a lot, right? But when you start to enter Momoyama, there's less and less fights. And then when you enter in Edo, there's no fight anymore, right?
Yeah.
So and Katori Shintoryu, which is the most ancient or one of the most ancient, is what, I don't remember, 15th century? 14 something, I think. I don't remember. Anyway, so it was at the time where there's a lot of battlefield stuff happening, a lot of wars. And but then they never used it on the battlefield, right? It was like mostly...
Even Katori, I mean, even the ancient schools. If you take Ogasawara, it's probably the oldest school.
It is the oldest school.
And it's also the school of Regi, and they do a lot of art-related stuff. Mm. And if you think about the Edo period, it's 250 years of... doing tea ceremony instead of fighting.
That's why like a combat system in Japan, you can consider them as a martial arts, is because they never had to be used as a combat system after all, like most of them. Of course, some of the oldest tradition a bit maybe, but whatever's been made in during Edo period is not necessarily proven like to be effective, because they never had to, in maybe, I don't know, 80% or 90% of the cases, they couldn't use it anyway. So yeah,
and in the few cases they were used, like Musashi and his Niten Ichiryu, basically it's not Niten Ichiryu who defeated people, it's Musashi
himself.
No, it's Musashi,
so. Because there's no, I mean, Niten Ichiryu, it's kind of, it's at the end of his life, right?
Yeah.
When he's fighting everybody, it's not Niten Ichiryu, I don't remember the name.
But even if the technique is there, the one guy fighting with the system doesn't make the system good. It makes the guys good. If many guys would with the same system win a lot of battles, you could say, okay, this system is efficient. But all the times it's only one guy, the one guy in history with this school, and then the school becomes very famous.
Musashi didn't have many students, right? So yeah, before Niten, it was Enmeilyu, right? Enmeilyu.
Yeah.
Enmeilyu. You read the. What's the first book he wrote? I can't. I'm tired today. My brain doesn't work. Edokyo. Is this? Yeah, Edokyo is his first. Yeah. So if you read the Edokyo, or if you read the Sanjugokajo or Heihoka Kitsuke, so there's like a lot of stuff written in there, right? But first of all, it's not designed for battlefield. It's more designed for duel, like one-on-one in the street stuff. And then it's like the guy had like two students, maybe three, but nobody really heard about how good Musashi's students were, right? We don't know. Maybe they were good, maybe they were not. But we know Musashi because he's very good at marketing himself, right? With the
or his students were good at marketing.
Yeah, but he was kind of good at marketing himself too. I mean, he ends up at Hosokawa's place. I mean, he can have the booze and the food for free, and you know, it's like, oh yeah, I'm Musashi, man, so where's the beer? And I just show up at Osokawa's place, and Osokawa says, yeah, have fun, it's cool. And so he's famous when, you know, it's not, if the guy's not famous and you knock, I want to be your, you know, or to say maître d'armes, like martial art teacher, and the guy said, "Who the fuck are you?" I was like, "I don't know you," but like he was famous enough already to be Osokawa's teacher. So I was definitely good at marketing, I'm sure. And Yagyu Munino, he was a good marketer too. So yeah, but then can you say that what they did was art? Probably not. Maybe what their students took from them and codified and made into a system became an art somehow, but the people who really fought, like really, really killed people, and I don't think they were considering that as an art. Probably not. I don't know. We're not, we never know what they thought, but...
Well, the I've heard of all the references of arts within samurai teachings, and more or less combined with martial teachings.
Yeah, but
it's mostly during the Edo period.
Yeah, but like the thing is, like, is it really true? Again, I'm not an historian, but like, you know, when you, let's say you study Naginata, for example, a good example, Naginata, it's like, oh, you know, Naginata, Onabu Geisha, and women's martial arts. But it's like, it's completely fake. It's been created like from, you know, pieces and stuff put together Meiji period to make some kind of like training system and propaganda for the kids. That's, but like, there's, of course, there are Onabu Geisha in Japan doing Naginata stuff, but it's like very, very small cases. It's not like all the women were doing Naginata, and like Naginata is the prod weapon of Japanese women. That's bullshit. It's like it's in Japanese books because it's for the propaganda, and then it's maybe in some Western's book because you need to keep in track with the propaganda to be nice with the Federation and all that political stuff. But then everybody knows it's not true. That's like there's people doing real research on Naginata. They all say there's no clue about, no proof, nothing about that. It's just a big lie which you take. You make it look better, you put a cherry on the cake, and then it's the tradition. It's like, oh, this is how it was. But, and so a lot of connection between, again, the connection with Zen and martial arts. I mean, as soon as you start to, you know, dig into it, a lot of researchers and scholars, even in Japan, starting to say, you know, Zen and Kudo and like hairy girl. And it's like, it's fake, it's a lie, it never happened. And the guys, we can, you know, kind of prove it. And then the connection between like the samurai, Bunbu, Ryodo and stuff, of course, it was the ideal, and a lot of samurai was good at writing and probably good at painting, but it was probably a very, very limited number of them. So you have the ideal of the samurai who was good at martial arts and is good at painting or writing poetry. So the idea is there and it's something you should tend to. But how many were actually good in art and shodo and tea ceremony? And question is, how many were actually good in martial arts?
Well, during the Edo period, they had not that use for
no, but the thing
practice,
is,
martial arts, and a lot of free time for arts, given how...
Because it's very easy to say, oh, like Edo period, all the samurais were so strong, they're so this, it sounds like a Netflix shit, but, you know, it's like, yeah, the samurai. So it's like, were they really good in martial arts? We don't know, because if they were that good, why would, like, what's his name? Yoshimune? Number nine shogun, was it Yoshimune?
Yoshimune,
I think. Why was Yoshimune complaining about the poor level of most of the samurai? They can't do shit. And he had to, you know, bust all those fake dojo. There were already fake dojo at the beginning of the 18th century. And it's like, yeah, you know, Kaho Kenpo, like Flowery Kenjutsu. It's like there's a pile of crappy martial arts that everybody do, and they all suck at it. And then the shogun gets mad. I mean, it tells you some shit, right? It's like, oh, the samurai, they can't even do martial arts, man. So I'm not sure they can do arts very well. So, but then, that's the reality. So there's like the ideal of Bunbu Ryodo, and then there's probably the reality of a lot of people can't do either of them. And there's some people in the middle who are good at one of the two, and then you have a few people who can do the two, but it's probably like what happens nowadays anyway. It's like in a martial arts federation, you have a few top people who can do a lot of stuff and embody the martial way, and they do calligraphy, and then a lot of people, they're just beginners, or they have poor skills. And I think it's a very natural thing. It's like if you start to think samurais were like some kind of semi-gods, and they could do everything, they could fight and stuff. Well, maybe in Muromachi period, probably, because they had to fight, otherwise they would be killed. But from Edo, they're just bureaucrats, right? They don't do shit. It's like they're typing Excels or Word stuff, and they get paid for it. That's all they do. So, I mean, not all of them, but some of them. Most of them. And so, yeah, but then you need to build a tradition, right? It's like, especially when you're Japan at the beginning of Meiji period, you want to make Japan like, you know, a modern state with a very long cultural
All countries
background, of course,
do that to some extent. But when you have a healthy research community and things can slowly move forward, and you can unveil the truth of the history, the problem with Japan is that the research community is not
It's very limited. It's not very healthy. There's some very good scholars, of course, but they are in limited numbers. And sometimes they cannot say what they want. It's true. I mean, let's face it. Even sometimes, some people cannot say what they want because there's some, you know, problem with the federations and
some projects that were
abandoned, or like say, oh, dude, maybe don't do that project. You can do it if you want, but don't do it. I just like, okay, well. So, no, it's not healthy. Definitely, it's hard to be a researcher here in Japan because you cannot tell whatever you want. But then again, a lot of stuff that went to the West at the beginning, went to the West with people who were not necessarily researchers. So they had kind of an idea of what Japan was in the 16th century or 17th century, based on the propaganda,
they just bought what the Japanese were selling. So.
Well, exactly, yeah. And then that's it. But there's a lot of stuff like, there's a French guy, kind of famous, I can't remember his name. So, but he's famous. It's a bit Robert Buragua. Is a specialist in yoloi, like armor. He's done like very serious studies. I think it's Buragua, but anyway. And he, after like 10 years of studies, like very serious stuff, he was like, dude, the Myochin lineage of yoloi maker, which was the most, you know, famous. The Myochin is like, when you think yoloi armor, you think Myochin, right? It's like their lineage is completely fake. It's like there's nothing. It's like it's fake all the way along. And then he had the document, he could prove it. And then, like most of the people in Japan say, oh, no, he's a foreigner, don't listen to that. The Myochin is a helai. Like it's the dento, it's like the tradition of armor maker in Japan. You cannot touch them. He said, maybe, but their lineage is crap. It's like it's completely faked.
But how many times
when you're that happens in every martial arts?
Yeah, when you're looking at the history of this or that Kobudo, and you're doing research. I mean, we did a lot of research for the descriptions we did for.
And you know very well that it's already hard to find reliable sources and stuff for modern Budo.
Yeah, but
so Kobudo, like the stuff.
Kobudo, you have one source that says A, one source that says B, and the current official version is kind of a mix of A and B. And then one day you just find a reliable source that contradicts everything and say, who's correct? So you, when you can, you ask the school, and the answer is always the same.
Don't look
we don't know. There is just an official story, but For the rest, we don't know. Actually, it's not that they don't know. They don't care.
Yeah, and they don't want, because, you know, it's martial arts. So in many schools and many stuff. There's a lot of bad things happening, which happened, you know, during the war, before the war, and then even in the past. So there's a lot of truth and stuff that people don't want you to uncover. If you really want to have a clear, nice image of what Japanese martial arts were, you just read Shinbudo, and then everything's there. You know, it's like it's pretty bad.
Shinbudo is a very good resource.
But then, how many foreigners read Shinbudo? Not so many. Even me. I have them. It's not like I'm studying them, but like you just read a few articles, it's like, oh shit, man.
Yeah, when we were looking stuff on Aikido and Daitoryu with Guillaume, we went through a few articles, and then when you read, it's like, it's heavy. And what's crazy is that you can read some very famous guy who wrote in Shinbudo something, and the same guy 15 years later writing the complete opposite than what was in Shinbudo, which means the same guy is clearly objectively lying, creating a new story, but no one cares.
Yeah, but the thing is, like, if you sell the Japanese martial arts as a way to self-enlightenment and self-realization and peace in the world and stuff, if that's the marketing of the Japanese martial arts nowadays, let's be clear, or sports, it's either one or the other. You cannot have people looking into the past, or like in Shinbudo, and say, oh, okay, well, that's definitely not the case like 10 years before you created the Federation. It's like a lot of people are very violent and very extremist, and the same people later say, oh yeah, Budo is about peace. But if you don't want to have people researching that topic because it doesn't look good for your Federation, right? Whatever federation it may be. So, yeah.
Well, there are a few exceptions.
But we're starting to not talking of, we're losing track of the art thing. Are we going into the political stuff? Which is very interesting. And especially nowadays with all the conspiracy theories, it's going to be a good video on YouTube, I'm sure. Like it, and don't forget to do the bell stuff, right?
if you say that there is no obvious art component in Budo, then you have to say, then, since it's called martial arts in English, and then the martial part is quite obvious, then you have to explain what's more than that martial.
But the thing is, the answer is there is art in martial arts, but the thing is, it's just, you cannot, there's no way to explain it. It's like elusive, I would say. You cannot quantify it, you cannot put a word on it. There's definitely art in martial arts, otherwise it would just be some kind of MMA fight. But in martial arts, there's all those techniques that never work. It's purely for body training or feeling of the space and the timing and everything. And they are very beautiful techniques, right? They're not necessarily work, they're not necessarily efficient, but so there's beauty in some of the techniques, so there is art, but how can you define it is something you shouldn't define, actually. It should stay as an elusive part of it.
Well, if you do judo, you know that judo was created as an educational tool, so it's basically not really anchored in martial arts, and nowadays with the sports judo, you really cannot see much beauty in
competition. But sometimes there are very nice moves in competition. Sometimes it's very boring and they just wait for the time to go down and get some penalty points or something. But
saying the same for kendo. If you look at kendo competition, it's very hard to see the beauty of competition, except when you're looking
Hachidan level, yeah. Kids kendo as
But you have kata in kendo and you have kata in judo, so there is also a this dimension. And when you see judo practiced outside of the competition or the veteran level, like 40 years old and older, then you can see very different techniques. So but art is maybe something that comes with...
Yeah, but I think it's too easy to say there is art in martial arts because there are kata. Because that's the answer that everybody would say, oh yeah, but there are kata, you know, man, it's like it's artistic.
No. I don't say that kata is artistic in itself, but I say at least there is one element in the art that is for the preservation of the form. Mm. So it's not only competition. And just to make the link, people are a certain age, maybe 40 or 50 or older, that when they stayed in the martial arts past the competition, then they often have a practice that is more beautiful and I would say somewhat artistic than the competition part. So maybe it requires time to...
Because it's probably because of the age more than, the, you know, it's like when you're young, you can jump everywhere, but then I get tired very quickly, man. It's like, more 30 seconds and I'm dead. So
but if you get tired more quickly, you need more efficient movements. So you have a technical research that you probably don't need when you're doing the competition, for example. I mean, maybe it takes time, just time to...
Well, yeah, techniques are difficult, so they do take time to master. But anyway, next question.
Yeah, provocation. Would you say that some of the Budo you practice now is artistic, visually speaking?
I mean, well, it can be artistic, but it depends.
You, when you practice.
When I practice, if people think I look artistic,
yeah.
I don't know, girls say I look hot, but guys do sometimes. So yeah, I'm hot, but I don't know if I'm artistic, man. No, I don't know. Well, I'm not, how can I say that? First of all, I'm not very good at fighting with Mukujo. My turf is more the Tanken, right? No, Tanken fight, you know, it's like, it looks like a bar fight or something. It doesn't really look nice. I mean, it can look nice, but it's definitely not the most nicest looking martial arts. It's a bit raw, right?
We have a few videos of you in Kenjutsu and Naginata too.
Naginata, oh maybe. No, but like Kenjutsu maybe. Well, yeah, when you do like Kenjutsu or Naginata, like you mean like Tendo Ryu or Tatsumiryu or Ryuha, you have to be somehow, you have to look artistic somehow. But the thing is, when there is a dangerous trap, there is like trying to look artistic to the point that the technique don't work anymore. And you can see it a lot nowadays. A lot of people, they will work for their embu. Like, oh, we have an embu next month, so we need to be ready about the embu and stuff. But then all the time you spent rehearsing, it's not a training anymore, it's rehearsing for the embu, for the demonstration. It's not time you spend training in the martial art, you just rehearse a demonstration. And this is happening more and more and more, I think. A lot of people are gonna say I'm an idiot again, but okay. It's like, remember maybe like 20 years ago or something like that. I was in Japan 20 years ago, let's say 15 years ago. Or maybe if you see the old videos, like there was like the Kobudo Embu in March at the Budokan. And then you had probably the May one in Kyoto at the Butokuten. And maybe you had the Meiji Jingu in November, is it? Yeah, yeah, November. So you had like maybe three major events and that was it. Maybe there was even less stuff. I don't know. We need to ask the old people. But nowadays,
it's at least once a month.
Yeah, well, even once a week. Like, as a Nantoka Embu. Like, Waki Wakaranai, in the freaking Boondocks, they have Embu too. It's like, you can do, if you really like Embu, you can do Embu every week. If you spend like all your days rehearsing for the Embu that you're going to have every weekend, when do you train? And the thing is, like,
rehearsal becomes the training. So
yeah, that's the thing. As you can see, a lot of people now, they're so omnibulé, like,
focused.
For getting crazy about this embu thing, that I don't know if they still do keiko. Sometimes it seems like they do embu, and then So I'm not, I'm not a master or anything like that. But when I try to do embu, I rarely do embu because I don't like it much. And when I do embu, I try not to. I mean, I do rehearse it because you need to rehearse it. I mean, if you look like an idiot, it's not good. But when we do it, I remember like last time I did with Brian for Tendolieu, and it was like, okay, we do the embu, but we do it like full speed. And if we make a mistake, or if we just hit each other on the head or whatever, it's so be it. But you need to take a risk and do it at full speed, right? If you do it slightly slower so you can look nice, and then what's the point of doing embu? I think a good embu is an embu you fail, for me, because it means you put everything into it. If you do it a bit, below your capacity, so you're sure you're not going to fail it and it's going to look good, then I don't see the point. I think the last one we did tons of mistakes, and I mean mistakes, not mistakes, but like the timing was giddy, and the space, I was pushing him too much, and he had to back onto the fence or something. There was no space. And we could have said, oh no, let's do it very gently so there's the space. But I said, no, just do it like full speed and full power. And if you end up in the fence, then it's your problem, and it's like whatever. And the thing is, like, this mentality of doing it like for real kind of disappear, I would say. And now it's safe and it's rehearsed and it looks nice, but to me at least it looks boring. I was like,
would you say that?
But then again, you know, I'm not a master or anything like that. But I'm bored.
If you accept the art component in Budo, then would you say that the art component it's something that appear?
Yeah, I never understood the difference between might and may, man. It's like English. Same. English is a weird language.
Same.
Might, may, whatever.
May appear if someone trains a lot at some point in his practice, but not something that can be researched within the art, like by rehearsing the same movement over again, because
the
research,
like,
of art is killing the practice of Budo.
Yeah, but the thing is, like, if you're a dancer or if you're a choreographer or if you're a musician, let's say you play first violin in the whatever philharmonic orchestra in Paris, or if you play first violin there, then you need to rehearse a lot, and you need to be on cue, and you're a professional, right? If you do martial arts, not everybody is a professional in martial arts, actually not so many, especially in the Kobudo world, nobody is a professional almost. Being on cue, being looking nice, and is not the purpose of martial arts. But somehow there shouldn't be any embu, in my opinion. What's the point of doing a demonstration of martial arts? The point is to promote it, right? It's like, oh, we're doing martial arts, it's cool, people watching. I say, oh, I want to do that. And it's a good tool for promotion. But
there was a time it was an offering to gods.
But still, Hono embu, most of the embu are still Hono embu.
Yeah,
but
it's not the point anymore.
Yeah, right? Yeah. I mean, it's like, it's just an excuse. But I mean, for some people, like, they are really into Shintoism or stuff like that. Hono embu means a lot, for sure. But for a lot of people, that's like, yeah, whatever. Not Shintoist. Anyway, I'm not a Shintoist. So for me, the Hono embu concept, I understand it. I don't have any problem with it, but when I do a demonstration at the Meiji Jingu, I'm not doing any offering to gods, because I'm not Shinto, right? I'm kind of like atheist, so I don't really have any interest into God stuff or Jesus stuff or whatever stuff. I just do a demonstration, right? So the honohembu concept is wasted on me, and it's probably wasted on a lot of people because not so many people are that religious in Japan, right? Some are, but not everybody. The honohembu can be an excuse. And then the promotion is definitely an important aspect of doing a demonstration. But apart from that, what's the point? I don't know. I'm not a big fan of demonstration, to be honest. I don't see the point. That's like twisting, like, or changing the technique so it looks good. So during a demonstration, I was like, then just don't do any demonstration.
Yeah, it's counterproductive. Yeah. Christian Tissier was saying, if your technique is good, it's very probably going to be beautiful. But it's not because your technique is beautiful that it's a good technique.
Yeah, definitely. There's been a lot of, like, because of the embu somehow, I think. And, like, again, if you have one embu every year, you do it and you rehearse for it and it looks good and stuff. But if you have one embu every month, that's like, well, I think we're going back to the Kaho Kenpo Jidai.
It looks like
A lot of people are going to hate me for that, but...
you're right, it looks like
Like me already anyway.
It's a bit, the Kobudo are dying, so basically they're just setting events to fill the void. Every, like, 2 weeks, they take their car, they go, they meet, they do some embu, some training, then they have... You go to the izakaya, they have a glass, and then...
But the izakaya part is part of it, is probably the most important part of it, but...
It's more like community stuff than...
Yeah, and it's not necessarily a bad thing, but then...
If it replaces training, it's a problem.
Yeah, it's a problem, but it's like the community part of it can be interesting, but there should be, at least. I think we do it very well in tatsu milieu, actually. When I was studying tatsu milieu for a while, a lot of people a lot of old people are doing tatsu milieu, and it was really nice to be with all the old guys and the old women and talking about stuff and then drinking tea and having some nomikai, and it's pretty cool. But then at the same time, at the Honbu Dojo, they have dedicated training for advanced. So if you're not, let's say, I don't know, I think they had a dan system now. So if you're not a sandan or yondan or whatever, you cannot go to that training. And this is where they keep the serious shit happening, right? And then you have the second, let's say, layer of, like, community people enjoying a bit of training and a bit of... And I think this is nice. There's no need to be completely hardcore, you know, like doing some barefoot stuff under the fall in the mountain and, you know, and... in the snow and ninja stuff under the roof or on the roof. I mean, it's cool, but there's no need to be super hardcore all the time. But then the opposite is true too. I mean, if it's only community stuff, and then the school dies somehow. So you need to have a layer of hardcore people doing the hardcore shit, and then more like, mild people keeping...
Well, that's kind of how the Budo world, Shinbudo works. I mean, you have in Judo, you have people doing competition.
Shinbudo, you mean like modern Budo?
And in Aikido.
Because in Shinbudo, no.
No, it's
you mean Gendai Budo, yeah.
Yeah, in Shinbudo, it was a hard shit only. In Gendai Budo, I prefer the term Shinbudo because it's kind of post-war transformation of Budo.
Yeah, but then again, there's the connotation with Shinbudo during the war, so I don't think it's a good... Or you say, like for katana, Shinto.
Yeah.
So you can say Shinbudo.
And I mean, how many judoka really do high-level competition? Very few. 95% of the judoka are like kids or casual practitioners, and they make the art live. Less casual in Japan, lots of casual in France, but that's, in Aikido we have many, many, many casual practitioners. And probably without that, there is...
Yeah, but that's different. It's like, it's modern Budo, so it's a federation system which needs...
What I want to say is that if you don't have this... a large number of people bringing new blood and potentially good practitioners and some money and a group of really good practitioners, we can preserve the art. It's dying at some point. It's going to disappear.
I don't know, because I don't know. It's a very good question. I don't have the answer. But sometimes, let's say you look at old footage, like super old footage from like famous sensei. Like, I think they have like very nice footage of Don Draeger doing some stuff, you know. Mm-hmm. And I was like, man, it's superb, it's impressive. What they do is super fast, it's precise, there's sai, there's like, it's crisp, it's... But then, how many people do you see achieving a level like that nowadays? Not so many.
But how many people do have the ability to train so many hours?
Well, true. I mean, nowadays, most people... So that's why, in the sense...
So you need like, professionals, yeah, so you need money, so you need more people. The balance is very difficult to find.
That's why I think they're doing good in kendo in Japan, because they're all policemen, so they're professional kendo player anyway. In the army, for Jukendo, the level is super high, because that's what they do. They just do bayonet stuff all day long. I mean, not all day long, but... I mean, they're professionals, so the level stays high. But when you don't have professionals, but you still want to keep the level high, do you dilute the teaching into a lot of people, or do you keep it core? I don't know.
It's a balance of... if you want to find good people, you need to... Well, advertise what you're doing and bring people in. And
because I don't know I'm not a professional martial art. I mean, I do a lot, but I don't make a living out of it, right? I'm not a professional.
And they don't even allow you to get money when you do seminars.
Yeah, true. doesn't matter, but I don't mind. But like, I'm not a professional, so I don't. Even if like I have students and I'm very happy when they get better, and even when they compete, if they win some match or something, I'm very happy. And it's kind of my responsibility to teach them how to be better at what they do. But I have a responsibility, but I don't have an obligation. If I'm a professional, then people pay me to do, then I feel like I have an obligation for them to get at the best level they can, right? Because they pay me for that. If they don't pay me, I have the responsibility to teach them properly, but that's it. I mean, if they fail their dance exam, they fail their dance exam, and it's not on me, right? If I teach them crap, then it's on me. And so I have the responsibility to teach the proper thing, but then I don't have the obligation for success. And so since I don't know the professional martial art world, it's hard for me to talk on that stuff. I'm doing a seminar, and then people pay $500 for a weekend to go. Nobody would pay that to go with me, but
you would be doing ninjutsu in that case.
Yeah, I mean, let's not go into that kind of like chit chat and trashing people. It's not good, but yeah,
no, but that's not what I'm doing. It's because it's the pricing is more in that
yeah,
area.
But so, I mean, I don't remember what I wanted to say, but like, yeah, I'm not, I don't know anything about getting paid to teach martial arts. So it's hard for me to know what people on that side of the game need, what they need, what they have to do. Their rights and what, it's a world I know nothing about. So it's for me, it's hard to talk. I can only talk about like people who like martial arts, train a lot, do a lot of research in Japan and everything, but don't get paid for it.
At a time.
So it's not the same tension and not the same balance, I would say.
There was a time in Kobudo where donations were quite a huge source of funding for Kobudo schools, which is still a little the case nowadays, but far less than it used to be.
When we go to seminars, I mean, I get donations. It's mostly a beer, but I guess it's a form of donation, which is highly appreciated. But the donation stuff in the Kobudo War, I mean, you're talking about many, 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 many years ago. I don't think it exists anymore.
It still does exist, but it's a really tiny source of funding in comparison to what it was 50 years
ago. Yeah, when I used to learn, I don't know, like Ishin Yu or whatever, 10 WS, like I used to pay $5 Goyakuen for a full weekend or whatever. It was for the tea. It was the Ochadai. So I was like, it's not $500 for a weekend, it's 500 yen. So it's like $5, you know, for a full weekend of training. I'm coming from that world. So
I was thinking of the donations because, in Catholic Shintoryu, for example, you have a few people that are wealthy businessmen or politicians or whatever who have quite a lot of money and want to support.
But that's the art. It's true for every federation, so like a lot of like Naginata federations or Jukendo federations.
No, I mean, when you have donations, then you can afford to not have your student pay for what you're doing. That can offset this student.
Yeah, but often the donations are for the federation and not for the people who teach in it.
In Kendo maybe, but in Kobudo it's small, so it just allows the dojo to survive. That it can help offset this problem of having the student paying and expecting a result. If the person actually paying for it is not himself expecting any results through a donation, which is, or you can do like the HK, you do both, people pay and you have donations, but that's yet another...
Another system. Next question.
Now, anything else you want to talk about? More or less art-related topics or everyday good use of martial arts?
Well, good use of martial arts is just not using it. Janai? It's like, I think, especially nowadays, most of Japanese martial arts are for keeping a healthy body, trying to keep a healthy mind, which is not easy.
Socializing with Japanese people.
If you want to use martial arts, or just do MMA, it's just faster. Military combat training.
Enlist for the military. Yeah, works too.
But that's, otherwise it's not the point. It doesn't help you. It just makes you look like an idiot when you think you can do some self defense with your kendo or aikido. It's like, okay, dude, let's go on with your aikido and do the Navy SEALs stuff and see how far you go. But yeah, I mean, martial arts, it's good for. Finally, it's good for self. It's the claim, right? It's good for self development. That's the goal of modern Budo, is Ningen Kese, and it is what it is. It's true. Although we laugh about it a lot because there's a lot of if you're not in Japan, maybe you don't know, but like in Japan, there's a lot of political stuff and a lot of bullshit, and there's a lot of cool stuff too, but there's a lot of bullshit too, and then sometimes the Ningen Kese part of it can get disappear in the fog somehow, but still it's there, it's true. I mean, if you really want to get better, or if you want to improve yourself or whatever through martial arts, you can. But you don't need to do martial arts, you can do whatever. You can do free climbing, free diving, you can do wingsuit if you like to fly. There's tons of millions of shit you can do in your life to improve yourself. It doesn't need to be martial arts. It's not because you do martial arts that you get better. It's you get better only if you want to get better. That's it. And if you want to get better by doing horse riding, works too. So yeah, the thing is, a lot of people think because Ningen Kese, it's the goal of martial arts, they think that because you do martial arts, you're necessarily a good person. But I know tons of really bad people doing martial arts in Japan, and I know tons of really good people doing martial arts in Japan.
And lots of good people not doing martial arts.
Oh yeah. So it's just like, it's an ideal, it's a principle, but it doesn't mean you reach it, or it doesn't mean that everybody live by that ideal, I would say. But then again, the best is to come to Japan and train there, because if you train only in Europe, it's a very different culture and different setting. So it's good if you can experience Japan. So whenever we can fly again, come to Japan. It's cool. And there's a lot of izakaya thing happening. So
yeah, and they're going to need a lot of foreigners coming in to train if they want to survive, because many groups are in great difficulties because of the COVID situation.
A lot of people have trouble training and stuff, that's for sure. But then if it's only foreigners coming as tourists and stay 2 days and come back, it doesn't really help either. So if you want to help, you should come here and stay here. I don't know who would be stupid enough to do that.
We did it.
Oh yeah, but we never say, when nobody said we were smart. Probably not. Anyway, so I guess that's it. Or do you want to hear anything? Any more wisdom from me? Or
no, a conclusion on is there art or no art in Budo?
There is art only if you want to find it, and if you think there is. If you think there is no art, then there is no. I think that's a personal.
So as someone we both know, Budo is just a place you can find what you're looking for, and you won't find what you're not looking for.
Exactly. It's a framework for whatever you want to do. That's it. It's a tool. The tool works great. I mean, in the hand of the very gifted person. If you're an idiot, even if you have a very nice tool, it's not going to make you any better. Unless you use the tool for years and years and years and years. But yeah, I guess. Okay. So time for the izakaya thing or what?
Yeah, so we're going to socialize. Thank you very much for watching. Thank you very much, Baptiste, for the interview. I know you're tired because it was a long day.
Oh, yeah.
I'm a bit tired too.
And please put the like and all that stuff, you know, like...
Like, subscribe, wait for the next one.
I'd be really disappointed if Bennett does better than me on the like count, so... I don't want to be beaten by Alex again, so please like the freaking video.
We're going to have two interviews that might come out before this one. One of them might, I don't know. But with a woman...
You don't need to announce
with
them.
Woman at last. No, I want to say I'm happy to finally have the opportunity to have women. It's hard in Budo to find... women that are willing to talk on camera, and I've made a few offers, but it took time before one accepts. So we're gonna have a different perspective, and the two next videos we are shooting, and at one might get out before this one, but the other one will come after anyway. Thank you very much for watching. So subscribe, because the next videos are going to be nice. And thank you very much, Baptiste.
No problem.
See you soon on the next one.
Well, I was here anyway, so.
Cheers.
Okay, cheers.